Hey, everybody. Welcome to today's presentation on getting started with Amazon DynamoDB Global Tables. I'm Chad Tindall, and I'm a Principal NoSQL Specialist Solution Architect here at AWS, and I'm going to walk you through this presentation today.
I just wanted to give a brief overview of DynamoDB before we jump into the deep end of Global Tables. DynamoDB is a fast, flexible NoSQL database service which delivers consistent single-digit millisecond response times at any scale. And when we say any scale, we mean literally millions or tens of millions of transactions per second. What's great about DynamoDB is that your capacity can automatically scale up and down as your usage demands it, so there's no need to pay to provision for your peak utilization 24/7. Your application can start small, and then DynamoDB can grow to meet whatever throughput needs you require. Not only can DynamoDB do that level of scale, but it does so with a consistent single-digit millisecond response time. So even if you're doing tens of millions of transactions per second, as you're inserting rows, updating rows, deleting rows, you should be seeing that consistent single-digit millisecond response time from the service. The other nice thing about the service is that there's no servers to manage, so it's really just an API endpoint that you're hitting, and you don't have to think about how big is my cluster, do I need to upgrade the software, do I need to take downtime in my database for various upgrades and patching. None of that really happens in DynamoDB, and it's just not something you have to worry about, which does make it really nice. And of course, there's a whole host of enterprise features that are there you can read about. That's not really the focus of today's talk, so why don't we just keep going here real quick. Before we dive into a discussion about multi-region setup with Global Tables, I think it's important to understand what DynamoDB does provide even with you're operating within a single region. So it does provide a strong level of business continuity and disaster recovery solutions in terms of backups and restores. All of your DynamoDB data is going to be redundant across three different availability zones within a region. So there's three copies of your data in three different AZs. Should there be a local outage or some sort of power problem, of course, the other two AZs should be fine. And when you're operating within a single region, DynamoDB provides an availability SLA of four nines, 99.99%. If you're operating in a single region of AWS, DynamoDB cannot provide that consistent low latency globally, meaning that if you have a user who's coming in from, say, another country or another continent, and you're reading across to the DynamoDB table in whatever region you're operating in, you might see inconsistent latencies based on how far away you are from that particular AWS region when you go to access it. The other thing you can't do with a single AWS region is to provide five nines of availability. These two things that I just discussed will be something that we address as we move into a multi-region configuration with Global Tables. So you want to be able to protect yourself in the event that service does go down in one of your regions. You might see some higher increased latencies, higher increased error rates in that particular region, and you want to fail over your application to another region. So you want to make sure that your data is replicated into multiple regions so that when you do fail that application over, your data is already there and you're good to go. The other reason why you might want to go multi-region is if you have a geographically distributed customer base and you have users logging in or using your application from different countries, different continents, and you want to have multiple copies of your data that are located close to where those users are so that they get that low latency response time from your application and you don't have users from the European Union talking to a server in San Francisco or vice versa. And Global Tables allows you to do that by going multi-region. So this is a simple architecture describing how Global Tables works. Essentially, we have DynamoDB tables running in multiple regions. You can see that in the picture. We have our application, in this case, a simple deployment. We have our application running in region A, and that application is going to be talking to a DynamoDB table in the same region. As that application makes changes to that DynamoDB table, the change events will be copied into the DynamoDB stream, and the Global Tables replication infrastructure is acting as a listener on that stream and then sending those changes to its peers in another region, which can then write those changes to the DynamoDB table in the other region. So you don't want to think about a global table as one entity. Actually, what you have is, in this case, you have two separate DynamoDB tables, one in each region, and there's a replication infrastructure and a replication relationship that's configured between them. So that's really the mental model that you want to have. There's no special networking to set up. You don't have to do any crazy VPC magic or routing or any of that stuff. This is all fully managed by the DynamoDB service. And what happens is, as
you're writing into this DynamoDB table and the replication is happening, we will converge the system to a consistent state eventually, right? If you looked at any particular moment in time, there might be a transaction from region A that hasn't yet replicated to region B. That's just the nature of the speed of light. But, you know, given enough time, you would see that those two tables would reach a consistent state. And when we go to global tables, now we have this availability SLA of 5 9s, right? As long as we're having two or more regions participating, our availability SLA is 5 9s. If we just have one region, it was 4 9s. That was what we saw before. So just from a latency point of view, I mentioned that when we're accessing a DynamoDB table in a particular region, we should see consistent single-digit millisecond response times. And that may be 3 milliseconds, 5 milliseconds, 7, 8 milliseconds. You're going to see a little bit of variance there, but it will be consistently in that range. Replication time from one region to another obviously does take into account and varies based on how far away the two regions are from each other. So replicating from Virginia to Ohio, US East 1 to US East 2, is going to have a little bit lower replication lag than, say, replicating from Virginia to Frankfurt. But what you should expect to see is that that replication is happening around 1 to 2 seconds. So it might be a little faster if the regions are close together. It might be a little longer than 1 second if the regions are further apart. But generally speaking, we see that replication finish in about 1 to 2 seconds. There's no real hard limit to the number of regions which can participate in a global tables configuration. The pictures we've been talking about were showing two regions, but you could have 3 regions, 4 regions, 8 regions, 10 regions, however many you want, up to all of the regions that are available within your AWS configuration. Of course, the more regions that you add, your storage costs will increase, your write costs will increase because we have to write that copy of the data across more and more regions. But whatever it is that's required for meeting your business requirements, DynamoDB is going to be there in all of those regions that you need. DynamoDB actually operates in what we call a multi-active configuration mode, meaning that all of the regions that are participating in the global tables are capable of accepting writes. Sometimes you might think of that as active-active, but because DynamoDB can have more than two regions participating, we call it a multi-active configuration. That means it needs a mechanism for dealing with conflict resolutions. If you happen to write, update, or delete the same item from two regions simultaneously, it needs to deal with that conflict, and it does. The replication mechanism in global tables does solve that problem for us. It uses a last writer wins mechanism, meaning that whichever region was written to most recently, based on the timestamp of the transaction log, that's going to be the mutation that stays in the database. So if I do an update in region A and I update the exact same row in region B kind of around the same time, whichever one has a later timestamp, that's going to be the update that remains inside of the table. We do ensure that all replicas converge to a consistent state. So that's definitely going to be something that's true. You're not going to end up with your data looking different in region A and region B because of this simultaneous transaction. It won't happen that way. I want to talk really quickly about a major customer use case. As a father of 4 kids, Disney Plus is popular in our household, and Disney Plus is a big user of DynamoDB. Their first use case that they came to us with was the need to store the last viewed location, what they call it, a bookmark. Essentially, as you're watching a TV show or a movie, the player that you're using, the client, the Disney Plus client that you're using, which might be a Roku app or an iPad app or web browser, whatever it is, every few seconds, it needs to send in the location that you're currently at in the stream so that you can stop the stream and resume it from where you left off later. And that data is stored inside of a DynamoDB global table. They have two different paths for accessing that data, depending on whether they're writing that data or whether they're reading that data back to restart the stream. So as you're watching the movie, every few seconds, the client's going to send a request through their telemetry service. That's going to flow through Kinesis data streams. And then they have a Lambda function that's sitting there pulling data off of the Kinesis data stream and updating your bookmark in the DynamoDB table. When they need to read that bookmark back, so you start up the client, you go to resume a stream, they use what they've written, something called the content API, and it's just for reading that data from the table. Because the writes are so heavy, they have millions of clients, you know, sending bookmark data all of the time. They need this a little bit more complex infrastructure for handling the writes of this service. That's why they use this telemetry service and Kinesis data streams. But, you know, the reading doesn't happen nearly as often. It just goes through their normal API gateway, and that's how that route works. once you start using DynamoDB and get comfortable with it and using it, certainly in a global context like global tables, it's not uncommon to see that it can work well for other use cases inside of your application. And that's certainly been true here at Disney Plus. They've also implemented the Watchlist functionality. You could think about this like bookmarking something or adding something to a list that you want to watch later. That works on DynamoDB. Their architecture is much simpler because you're not doing this every few seconds. Again, they just go through the straight content API, so they can add and remove an item from your watch list, or they have an API call for getting all of your watch list items so the client can display them to you, and that sits inside of their watch list global table. A third use case that they've done is for their recommendation engine. So they want to show you, you've watched certain things, people who watch those things, you might want to watch this other thing. And they store those recommendations inside of a DynamoDB global table. But first, those recommendations actually come out of a machine learning job. So what you see over on the far right side of this slide is that they have a machine learning job running that's running all their algorithms for determining the proper recommendations. Those things flow through a stream and a writer and end up in the recommendations global table for your account, so they can pull that very quickly when you log into the app and go to the homepage. Then when you actually do log into the app and go to the homepage, the request for that comes through their content API, just like we've seen for the previous two instances. And that's kind of how that works. So you see, it's very common to have multiple different use cases. Once you start using DynamoDB for something, it just kind of spreads out because it's so easy to use and just very fast. All right, let's break over here and get a quick demo, just showing how easy it is to create a new DynamoDB table that has replicas in other regions. Okay, so what I'm going to show you here is just the process of creating a table in DynamoDB and adding a couple of regions to a global table's configuration for that table. So I'll name it global table test, partition key PK, sort key SK, just keep it very simple. And I'm going to go into on-demand mode for this, just because I like on-demand mode a lot. So I'm going to create that DynamoDB table. Once it's active, which shouldn't take very long. Okay, so our table is now active. I'm going to click into that, and I can see that there's a global tables tab up here inside of my table configuration. I'm just going to drill into that, and it's very simple. If I want to create a replica for this table, by the way, this table is running in US East 1, Northern Virginia. So if I want to create a replica for that table, all I have to do is choose which region I want to create that replica in. So I'm going to choose the Northern California region. Just click Create Replica. That's it. That's how easy it is to set up global tables to replicate data. It takes a second for that replica to come into existence in our table. All right, so now we can see that replica has come into existence on our table. It's in a creating state. Obviously, there's a little bit of work to do as it sets up the replica on the other side, and that should somewhat quickly move to an active state, which it has. And if we wanted to create more replicas, we can do that. So let's say I wanted to have a third replica that was running in Frankfurt. So let's do that. All right, so it showed up here. All right, so that's how easy it is to set up global tables across three separate regions. Let me show you really quick what it looks like when we actually go to write data into the table. So I can click into this table, I can click Explore Table Items. I can create an item, and I'll create an item with a PK value of foo and a sort key value of bar. And I'll add a new attribute. Let's say it's a string attribute with the attribute name test and the value test. That should be pretty straightforward. So I'll create that item. Okay. So that item exists. If I run a scan, I'll see that item is existing in my table. And if I switch over to, let's say, the Frankfurt region, which was one of my replicas. Let me make the fonts bigger so you can see it. And we'll see it right away. Actually, that item has already been replicated to this table. That's as easy as it is. It's like magic with DynamoDB. You don't have to do hardly anything. And the data is replicated faster than I can get to that region. All right, thanks for joining for our quick little session about getting started with DynamoDB global tables. What I want you to take away from this session is that global tables allows you to replicate your DynamoDB data across as many regions as you'd like to, that it works in a multi-active fashion, meaning that all of the regions are active and can accept reads and writes simultaneously, And then it's very easy to get started with. It's just literally a few clicks in the console and your data is replicating across multiple regions. Here's a link to the documentation page for DynamoDB Global Tables. It's a great place for getting started. And thanks for watching.